بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah, the compassionate, the most merciful to all of our viewers out there. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. And welcome again and thank you for joining us in the intersection of faith and reason with our guest, Dr. Jaafar Sheikh Idris. Dr. Jaafar, thank you again for being with us. So far it has been a real joy, and I believe we said at the very beginning that this was going to be intellectually stimulating, challenging and tickling. And every time we speak, I do feel tickled, as I am very sure that our viewers are as well, are as tickled as I am. Last time we spoke about the different arguments, the argument from design, and we ended up going back to the statement of Ibn Rushd, that the argument for the design speaks more of the attributes yeah. of the creator. And we said that there are two sources for knowing about this creator, the creation and revelation.
Yes.
And the Quran, I believe, speaks
about both
about both of them. Yeah. So in the part of creation, it was in the ayat, and I believe the verses that you quoted from Surah number 78, 6 through 16. And now we have got, what does revelation say about the creator?
Yes. Revelation, there are many arguments also related to revelation. But I think the most important argument is that this book, which is revealed to the Prophet, and I say this applies to all previous books, but unfortunately we don't have those books now.
But in the, at least in their original form when they were sent.
The book itself is a proof that it could not have been except from the Creator. And there are many arguments for this. But one of the arguments, which is, I'm choosing it because it's very clear, it is clearly a very rational argument. It says, وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. Had this book been from someone other than God, they would have found many discrepancies or contradictions also therein. So the Quran now is saying that there are no contradictions in this book, and therefore it must be, because if it were written by a human being, he would have contradicted himself. And I thought about this, and I have come up with some elaboration of this. When does the probability of contradicting oneself increase? It increases by the amount of time you spend in. If you speak for 5 minutes, you can be very careful. If you speak for an hour,
chances are more that you would be contradicting yourself.
If you say something today and tomorrow, and you speak every day like we have been speaking, say, for a week or so, and you are expressing your views, not like what we are doing here. We are not expressing our views. You are explaining something which is already there. Then the probability of your contradicting yourself increases. The Quran was revealed in the course of 23 years, and it was revealed in installments. A few verses today, a few verses after 7 days or a month, a few days after so on. And in spite of this, there is no contradiction. I said that imagine someone writing a column in a newspaper. He writes a column every week. And then after 2 years or so, he looks into what he wrote. I think he would laugh at himself. He said, would say, in January 1970, I said this. Yes. But in February 1972, I said this. So the probability of contradicting oneself increases. This because a human being is not perfect. A human being forgets. And also, his knowledge increases or decreases. That's why he is liable to contradict himself. It also, the probability of contradicting oneself increases also with the amount of what one says. يعني if you write a book, write an article of say 5 pages, the probability is less than if you write a book 500 pages.
Sure, it's controllable. You
know? Yes. 5 pages. So the Quran is a big size. And in spite of this, there are no concerns. Also, and this is very important, it increases with the probability of contradicting oneself increases with the amount of the subjects that you deal with.
Sure.
If you are a physicist and you are, this is your specialization, you write about physics only, the probability will be less than if like you become like some philosophers, who talk about physics, about religion, about economics, about then the probability of contradicting oneself increases.
Now, due to the variety of subjects that
yes,
are now
because
discussed
you can't
at
remember,
this point.
You might say something in economics that contradicts something, as we will give some examples, inshallah, that contradicts something that you say in politics.
Sure.
Now, the Quran, it speaks about the Creator and his attributes and so. It speaks about history, what happened in his. It speaks about the future. It speaks about social organization, economic, social, political, and so on. It speaks about moral behavior. So it speaks about psychology. And in spite of this, there are no contradictions.
Mm-hmm.
At first I used to think of contradiction as being just a contradiction between statements. Someone says a statement here that contradicts a statement in another place. But now I think that the contradiction can be, and this is more important in fact, between what, I don't know how to express it. Suppose that someone like Marx talks about economics and about politics. His aim, it is said, that was to make people free. He thought that capitalism was the cause of enslaving people. So he wanted people to be free. But his political system became the worst dictatorship. So what he said in politics contradicted
what he said in economics.
Yes, it did not contradict it in sense that it went against his aim.
Mm-hmm.
Some people now say that the same applies to democracy and capitalism.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Where democracy is a political system and capitalism is
economic system. Now, democracy says, for example, that everyone has the right to be a president, say, of the United States. All people are equal as far as this is concerned. But then capitalism gives this opportunity, only links this opportunity with wealth. If you are not yourself wealthy or you are supported by people who have money, then you have no chance, even if you are the most competent person to be the president of the United States. So there is a contradiction between these two.
Mm-hmm. One does not affirm.
Huh?
One does not affirm or confirm the
well,
other.
It contradicts it in the sense that it makes the claim of democracy void. You say, and this was one of the good criticisms of the Marxists. They say that Western democracy is only formal. It's only formal. It is not real, because you say everyone has the right to enter parliament. Yes, okay. This is in the constitution. But I cannot be a member of parliament if I am not supported by a political party, or if I am not rich. And that's why, interestingly enough, some people in the West who have Marxist leanings said that even election contradicts the purpose of democracy.
Hmm.
Because in elections, you are saying that some people are more competent than others. But democracy says no. Everyone,
supposedly.
Yes, yes, it's been. So what do we do? They said, we do what the Greeks did. Make it by lot. If you just, you say, I want to enter parliament. She says, I want to enter parliament. And then by lot, we choose who enter parliament. They say that this is more democratic than elections. In Islam, there is no contradiction of this kind. And I give you some examples. Islam is based, as we said, on belief in the Creator. So everything is designed to strengthen and preserve that belief. Everything. Mm-hmm. You worship, because without worshiping, you might forget your it might decrease or be weak and so on. Mm. Social life is organized in such a way that helps you to preserve your belief. And that is why it is very difficult for people like you who live in non-Islamic societies. It becomes more difficult for a person to do all that is required of him. For example, if you live in a country, say like Saudi Arabia, you can pray 5 times in a mosque, because there are thousands of mosques. Or you live in a place like Egypt or the Sudan, there are comparatively less, the opportunity is less, but again, and you meet Muslims, you learn from, and so on. But of course, some scholars said, in spite of this, it is better to go to non-Islamic countries to propagate the faith, mm-hmm. because the faith cannot be propagated while you are staying at home. So even if this is done at the expense of that good opportunity, it is better.
Then going becomes...
Also there is no contradiction between orders and prohibitions. In fact, the Quran justifies some of the orders and prohibitions in terms of that purpose. Mm-hmm. That people, for example, belief makes people brothers and sisters. Mm. This comes automatically. Now, everything that militates against this is forbidden. Mm-hmm. That is why alcoholic drinks are forbidden, drugs are forbidden, and the argument is very clear in the Quran. إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ الشَّيْطَانُ أَنْ يُوقَعَ بَيْنَكُمْ الْعَدَاوَةَ وَالْبَغْضَاءَ فِي الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ وَيَصُدَّكُمْ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَعَنِ الصَّلَاةِ. So the result of drinking is that people become enemies, they hate each other, eating and drink, alcoholic
intoxicants
drinks.
And gambling.
So there is no contradiction. And another example that I usually...
Sheikh, before you go on with that example, you're saying that there is this harmony between the principles proclaimed and then the prohibitions or the obligations that go along with it. Mm. We do have more examples. Please hold on to that thought. We'll take a short break. We're back here in the intersection of faith and reason with our Sheikh and guest here, Dr. Jafar Sheikh Idris. Sheikh, we were talking earlier about the rational argument for the credibility of revelation, and you chose one of them, a Quranic verse, وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدَ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافٍ كَثِيرًا. Had it been from other than Allah, they would have found many discrepancies in this book, the Quran, or as you say, any other previously revealed scripture in its original form from Allah.
Because God does not contradict himself.
And that is not befitting to neither his majesty nor his character. Mm. And you are giving us an example about how in other forms maybe the principles proclaimed do not necessarily, they're not congruent or they don't go in parallel with all the teachings, unlike the teachings of the Quran. And he gave the example of brotherhood and then what is prohibited as a result to keep this harmony between people. Yes. And you were about to give us some more examples.
Yeah, more examples are again of brotherhood. For example, if people are brothers, then the ruler is their brother. Mm-hmm. So he cannot be a dictator. So dictatorship is someone heard me criticizing democracy. And every time you criticize democracy, people think that you are defending dictatorship because they think that these are the only two alternatives. I said no. If I say I'm against the majority of the people legislating for me, of course I will say I'm against just one individual legislating for me.
Sure.
And some philosophers and also Muslim theologians said, if you follow someone obediently, consistently, if you obey them, then you are taking him as a god, even if you don't call him god.
Because absolute obedience is only befitting.
Yes. So a dictator, this is what a dictator demands. So he will not be your brother, he will be your master. Or your God. Mm-hmm. Also, say the example of zakat and interest or usury.
Zakat meaning the charitable alms that Muslims
give. Zakat takes from the wealth, the wealthy, and gives to the poor. Mm-hmm. But usury is from the poor to the rich, or from the less rich to the poor. So God could not have allowed usury, because this would have been against the principle of zakat. There would have been contradiction. On the one hand, you say the rich should give the poor. On the other hand, you say no, the poor should give the rich.
Interesting. It's interesting you say this. And if I may share with you and with our viewers out there, one time I was doing a paper on interest.
Yes.
In the States, and we have what we call payday cash loans. And these are places that you're supposed to go to, or you can go to receive a loan from them, and once you have your paycheck, they will take their money back, but you would have to pay them, of course, interest. And I was surprised to see the amount of interest that they charge. On a credit card, for example, they charge about 17.99 APR, annual percentage rate. When I went there, they charge 466.88%. And I remember the number vividly, and I said, but why do people come to you? And they said, well, these are majority of them are poor people who cannot afford a credit card because they have a bad credit, so they come to us. The poorer they're getting, the more interest is being charged,
and it makes them more make poor.
But they're not. They're not
the question of their poverty cannot be solved at all.
No, never.
No, and that's why one learned person directed me to I think it was a saying of I'm not sure whether it is a hadith, but I'm sure that it is the saying of one of the companions, and if not a hadith, then one of the companions of the Prophet, perhaps Umar. He said, "إذا أعطيتم فأغنوا." And when you give, don't distribute your zakah just in $10, $10, $10, but give a big amount to someone, make him rich, and then you solve his problem. Next time, he will not need
any more charity.
So zakah is supposed to solve the problem of poverty, not just to help the poor or to make the poor poorer. One American writer, I forgot the name of his book, but he said something, and he's not a Muslim. He doesn't know perhaps anything about Islam. He said that if there was a tax, and he said, I think, 3% or something very near to zakat, as he said, percent, perhaps he said three,
hmm.
on the capital of the rich people in the United States, this would have solved, there would have been no poor people in the world.
My God.
No.
Not in the United States.
Not in the United States.
In the world.
In the world. Just 3% of, say, anyone, of course, of someone like Bill Gates, or some someone second to Bill Gates in the same company, I think, they say that his income is like that of the of Kuwait. Just, imagine the income of just one person. So if you take zakah from that person annually itself, the problem of thousands.
And to be honest, Bill Gates is being very charitable lately.
Yes. what he is paying is much, much less than zakah. Now, also, I want to elaborate on this further. In Islam, the family is the basic unit of society, and therefore everything is designed in such a way as to preserve
that unit.
No sex outside marriage. No sex outside marriage, and that also is the reason why. People are allowed to marry more than one wife, because if you feel that you need to marry another wife and you are forbidden, this might tempt you to go to sex outside marriage. There is the hijab. Hijab is a word now. No. And no free mingling of men and women, because this increases the probability of sex outside marriage. And then there is a severe punishment for committing adultery or fornication. Many people now think that this punishment is very severe. Of course, if you allow women to dress like what they are dressing now and to mingle with men, and you see many people committing fornication or adultery and so on, of course you will be against whipping them or stoning them, because you will be stoning one quarter of the society or half the society, and no one will accept this. So you have to take the religion as a whole. You don't, if you take part of the religion, then it becomes inconsistent.
Mm-hmm.
If you replace one part with another, then it becomes inconsistent. So that's why it is wrong to say or to claim that religion can change with the change in time or the change in place, because it is very consistent. If it is consistent as it is, then if you make any change in it, it will not be consistent.
If you're just joining us, we are talking about this harmony in all the teachings of Islam, particularly the obligations and the prohibitions in in the Quran, with our guest here, Dr. Ja'far Sheikh Idris. Sheikh, does this apply to all things within the Quran? You gave us the example of brotherhood. Is this consistency all over the place?
All over the place. The main relationship with Muslims, people who are who worship God. I don't want people to think that Muslims are only the people who follow Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. People who followed Jesus were Muslims. People who followed Moses were Muslims. But it is a rule in the Quran that if you follow one prophet, if you believe in one prophet, you should believe in
all prophets.
There is no reason for you to pick and choose. And also, if you were a follower of one prophet, then another prophet comes after him, then you must
follow
that prophet. So it is a wrong argument that some people now use. You say we are following a prophet, Jesus or Moses, or so why should we follow Muhammad? We say that this is a contradiction, because if Muhammad is a prophet and he says that God sent him as his final prophet, then you should follow him. Mm-hmm. And if you study your religion carefully, you will find in that religion itself a reason why you should follow the prophet that comes after the prophet in whom you believe. So when we say that all these earlier messages were like the Quran in being consistent and being serving the making people happy in this life and the hereafter and so on, the only main differences are that this religion is more comprehensive mm-hmm. than others, and that in some of the details it is not like earlier religions, because this religion is for all humanity, not for a particular group of people at a particular time. So all people at particular times or places are invited to the fundamentals of the religion, that you worship none but God, that you do this, you do this. But when it comes to the details, there are differences among the different messages.
The main message remains the same,
yes.
But the different legislations that came yes. to serve that yes. may be different from one time, one yes. place yes. to another. Yes. Sheikh Ja'far, it's been a joy being with exactly. you here in this exactly. episode. Exactly. And we look forward to seeing more of you and hearing more of you in the coming episodes. With this, we come to the conclusion of this part of the program, hoping that you have enjoyed it as much as I did, and hoping that you would join us next time. Until then, we say so long. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.